Hello everybody, I'd like to welcome you to Samcraft. Today we're going to get really nerdy and geeky with the Shapeoko Pro. Hey everybody, my name is Sam and welcome back to Samcraft. That's right, today we're going to totally geek out. We're going to bust out some fancy tools and dial indicator and some other things because we're going to calibrate, square, verify, tram, and surface, all sorts of stuff on this Shapeoko Pro CNC. Now they make some specialized equipment and tools for tramming CNC machines that are much better than what you're going to see me use. Those things are also a lot more expensive than what you're going to see me use. And those people are getting more precise and being more finicky over measurements than what you're going to see me be. That being said, here's the procedure for how I trammed my CNC. First things first, let's go ahead and start with a sheet of plate glass and level it according to our router on the CNC. This is going to be the first step of tramming the router itself to make sure that it is exactly perfectly perpendicular to the surface of the wasteboard or the base of the table or the machining platform. So let me give you the 100 miles an hour looking out the window, there it went, version of how to level the plate glass, which is step one of this whole process. You want to get the piece of glass from your hardware store, find a location on your machine where you want to set it up, and using pieces of paper, you're going to shim it all around until it's perfectly level to your router. Now the way you find that it's perfectly level is you want to somehow stick a dial indicator on your router and move it left, right, front, back, and all over that glass until it reads the same measurement all across. What I ended up doing was using a scrap little piece of wood with a hole drilled on one end to clamp around a quarter inch end mill, and then I used a wood screw and attached my dial indicator to the other end of this piece of wood. You don't have to make something exactly like this to level the glass, but this piece will be useful for the tramming sequence, which is done after the glass is level. Now, truth be told, I spent a lot of time trying to get this thing level and got very frustrated. I don't know if I'm not very precise or whatever, but I could see my dial indicator moving around as I was pressing on things here and there, and I ultimately just had to go with what was good enough for Sam's standard. I don't plan on machining anything that needs high precision. I'm going to be doing woodworking out of this machine probably 98% of the time. The only times I really see myself sticking metal on this thing is if I want to make some branding irons or stamps or something of that sort, and the tolerances for something like that is pretty forgiving anyway. So just keep that in mind as you watch this video that this is Sam's okay with the precision level and it's not exactly 100% dead on. If you want to go crazy and make yours 100% dead on, go for it. You have better equipment or more patience than I do. With the glass perfectly level, I could then begin to tram the actual router and spindle mount itself. This took a long time as well. The fact that my dial indicator, as I rotated it, would become invisible to me because it's facing the other way was a big annoyance and a big hindrance, and I fiddled with that for a very long time. What I ended up doing in the end was using some machinist blocks, some 1-2-3 blocks that I got from Amazon, and I used them along with a set of feeler gauges to just get it right. As good as I could do with me, as precise as I was happy with. As far as getting the router mount level left to right, it was pretty easy using the 1-2-3 blocks stacked up on top of the glass. I knew the glass was perfectly level, so I just set it with feeler gauges and everything and made sure I had the same amount on left and right of the spindle mount. Pretty easy. As far as going front and back, how the spindle would tilt away or towards you as you're looking at the machine dead on, I got an idea from a friend of mine over at the Shapeoko Facebook group. There's a link to that down below. He said, just get a cheap set of feeler gauges and sacrifice them. Whatever thickness you need to move the top or the bottom out, stick that feeler gauge in there behind it and clamp it down. That was super good advice. That was amazingly easy to do, and I am very glad that I had the moment to talk with him, and he gave me the idea, and it sunk into my noggin. I've seen other people putting clamps on their rails and trying to twist the gantry this way and that way to get it right, and honestly, that's got to be a nightmare to do. Doing what I did was hard enough, and it's kind of like shortcut city. I could not imagine unbolting the gantry rails and twisting it and trying to get any kind of precision out of this thing. So, I would highly recommend going this route, because pretty easy is what I would say if asked about that. While I'm in the mood to torture myself with my machine, I might as well check its squareness and then check the calibration of the motors, both X and Y axis. Make sure that when I tell the machine to move it a set distance, that these stepper motors are doing the correct thing and actually moving that set distance. So let's keep going with this fun time of stuff. I'll start off by checking the squareness, and I'm just going to use the easiest thing I can, just corner to corner, and I'll just make sure they're the same on both sides that I choose. Hopefully this is accurate. I really, really hope so. So we are at 56 and 50, yeah. I can read a tape measure, I promise. 56 and 15 sixteenths, so one under 57. Please, please, please. Hot dog. Wow. Okay. This thing is perfectly square. Good. Whew. May advance to the next level. I'm going to go ahead and swap out my quarter inch end mill for my V-bit, because that's going to give me more of a pinpoint precise location to mark and measure travel distances with. I'm using some of these park tools. They're actually bike wrenches for the spindle or collet nuts and all that. These are super awesome. If you don't have a set of these and you got spindle work that you do, you need to get some. They're really cool and they're affordable. There's a link for them down below. My methodology for checking the calibration of my motors is one that I saw from another person's video on YouTube. There is a link below to this video. It is very detailed and was very helpful for me in doing this procedure. So I'm not taking the credit. I'm passing along the credit coin to the person who I watched and learned a lot from. To summarize the procedure for calibrating and checking your motor steps to reality, you use custom G-code commands to move the machine a set distance, then verify that distance with a tape measure or other measuring device. I chose to move 508 millimeters, which is the same as 20 inches, for my Y and X axis verifications. Again, see the video below for more details on this process from someone who did a much better technical explanation of this process. I am all done calibrating my machine. Thank goodness my X and Y motors were correct right out of the box, straight from the factory. Good job, Carbide 3D. Also, my machine is perfectly square. Awesome. That's a very good thing. The Pro is supposed to be self-squaring, but you never know until you measure, and mine was dead on as well. I am so glad that the squareness and the motor calibrations were correct, because honestly, tramming that thing was a nightmare enough. And I was kind of planning just to skip the other two, but I'm glad I didn't in the end. I now know my machine is square, my motors are correct, X and Y, and my router spindle mount is trammed, so now I can begin surfacing my wasteboard so that I have a nice flat surface for my stuff to go on top of. In order to figure out exactly how large of a surfacing job I need to make, I need to measure the travel of my machine. I'm going to put this thing at the far right corner, and travel all the way to the left and measure the distance, and do the same thing front to back to find out real life what size of a square I can do on my machine. I have finagled around and jogged around and found the actual real life footprint, I guess you could say, for the cutter from my Shapeoko Pro. And I am at 34 inches wide and 33 inches deep. I put those four corners of that measurement marked on my wasteboard so that I know to zero from them and run my flattening job. Now for the flattening job, all I'm going to do is set my material to be 34 inches wide, 33 inches long, or deep, whichever way you're looking at it, and tell the Carveco to make a pocket cut at 0.1 inches in depth. I will zero off the back left corner and let it run. Hopefully this won't take too long, but it's a pretty big surfacing job. So let's go ahead and load it up, design it in Carveco, and load it into Carbide Motion. For surfacing, I purchased a Whiteside name brand 1-inch wide or cut diameter Spoilboard surfacing bit. This is about 20 bucks on Amazon, and people seem to like it pretty good. This is the first time I've used it, so it still has the little gel, whatever, glue coating on it. So I need to go ahead and cut that off real quick. All right, all done and cleaned off. Now I'll use my two wrenches here, swap out my bit. This top one is a 13 millimeter, this bottom is a 22 millimeter, and that's what fits the Carbide name brand router. Now we can tell the Shapeoko to set the depth that we loaded a tool. We are all ready to set this thing back in that far left corner, because that's where I set my origin for this surfacing job. Go ahead and set it and run the job and begin surfacing this wasteboard. So, let's go. That wasteboard is all surfaced and now it has a nice size pocket in it, which kind of bugs my OCD. But it's okay, it is as big as the machine can cut, so I at least now know my safe areas to the outside, I guess. So I did learn a lesson with the surfacing bit as it relates to the BitSetter. And the lesson I learned is, it wasn't exactly correct on its depth. The surfacing bit kind of goes outside the BitSetter and it touches it and it still activates it. But it's not the cutting edge itself that activates the BitSetter, it's more of the other parts of the cutter. And so that made this job cut deeper than I was expecting or told it to. I don't exactly know a way around that unless I disable my BitSetter in Carbide Motion and then run this job and then remember to re-enable it for other jobs. I guess I just answered my question then. So yeah, if you have this and you have a BitSetter, make sure you disable the BitSetter, manually zero all your axes, and then run the job. Otherwise, you might run into issues like I did with your BitSetter not exactly referencing off of the blades itself of the surfacing bit and cutting a little bit deeper than you want. All things considered, it still worked out fine. I still have a perfectly flat wasteboard, and I now have done all the boring things with the CNC to move ahead with more projects. Not that I didn't make projects before, I've made a handful of things, but at least now I know my machine is square, my motors are calibrated, my wasteboard is flat, and my router is trammed and all that awesome, cool, geeky, nerdy stuff. I appreciate you guys watching as always. If you have any questions or comments, leave them for me down below. Otherwise, take care, and I'll see you guys next time in the workshop.